This episode of Dopey is brought to you by our very good friends at Oro Recovery, located out in sunny Southern California, created by our friend Bob Forrest and his friends Evan, Jared, and Bob. Their mission, to create a treatment center that treats addicts and alcoholics with compassion and connection rather than control. They have decades and decades and decades of experience in treating co-occurring mental illness, including SMI. They make sure your detox is as comfortable as possible, which is really great if you're kicking heroin or crack or meth or alcohol. You want a comfortable detox for sure. They have amenities you wouldn't believe: sound bath meditation, equine therapy, surfing, the potentially spiritually transformative sweat lodge. If you're fucked and you're willing to go to sunny Southern California to get help, I cannot suggest going to Oro enough. This episode of Dopey is also brought to you by our very good friends at Sober Buddy. Sober Buddy is an amazing app. They have a new free tracker of your sobriety. And you just go to yoursoberbuddy.com and get their free online sober tracker and then sign up for Your Sober Buddy. And you could do all these cool Sober Buddy challenges. It totally helps with sobriety. And actually, it makes my life better that I do these challenges. It's weird. I didn't expect it to actually impact my life, but I really like the Your Sober Buddy app. Please check it out at yoursoberbuddy.com or at the Google Store or the App Store. This episode of Dopey is also brought to you by our new friends at Dope. I'm hearing a lot of people enjoying the delicious cookie dough from Dope. They make incredible cookie dough. The brownie bites, the cookie monster, my favorite chocolate chip, so good. I saw their founder, Kelsey, on Shark Tank years ago. I heard it was called Dope, D-O-U-G-H-P, and I knew it was written in the stars. Kelsey, like me and most of you, is an addict in recovery, and she believes in ending the stigma around addiction and shining a spotlight on recovery. A portion of every delicious sale of Dope is also donated to She Recovers, a nonprofit charity with a mission to connect, support, and empower women in or seeking recovery. Life is raw. Cookie dough helps. Use Dopey15 for 15% off at DOUGHP.com or find them in select stores nationwide. This stuff is ridiculously tasty. If you're going to buy cookies or cookie dough, buy Dope at DOUGHP.com. Code Dopey15 for 15% off. Get it? This episode of Dopey is also brought to you by Evolution Accounting and Consulting. They are a full-service accounting firm that can help you with your taxes, bookkeeping, payroll, and almost any other business need you have. Thanks to technology, they work with people from all over the country and pride themselves on building exceptionally strong relationships with their clients. They say that their passion allows you to pursue yours because they understand the stress caused by worrying about taxes and other accounting issues. When you allow them to take this off your plate, you'll be freed up to focus on what you love to do. And perhaps more than anything else, the firm is run by a fucking crackhead. Fortunately, he's been in recovery for years now and knows the struggle as well as the success. Use promo code DOPEY when you connect with him at www.evolution-accounting.com to receive very special discounts. Before we get to the show, I want to tell you guys about Mobilize Recovery with my friend Ryan Hampton. It's an amazing cause that's going national this September, and it's a project really close to my heart. It's a nonprofit organization and a way for you to pitch in and help end overdose and addiction in America. There's a way for everyone to get involved. There is no cost and there is no hidden agenda. Mobilize Recovery is about you, your community, and what we can be doing together to inspire recovery solutions all across the United States. Here's Ryan.
Hey, everybody. This is Ryan Hampton, recovery advocate and founder of Mobilize Recovery. And I'm jumping on with Dopey today because we need you to help end overdose and addiction and inspire solutions for recovery across the United States. This September, the nonprofit initiative Mobilize Recovery is launching a national bus tour in partnership with iHeartMedia and Google. And we want to learn what your community, your organization, and your projects are doing to mobilize for change. Help us map the journey across the country. Learn more today at mobilizerecovery.org and submit your ideas to us. There's so many ways for you to get involved and to help us highlight the recovery experience that is so unique in different regions across all 50 states. Go to mobilizerecovery.org to learn more and to help us map this journey. And I hope we get to meet so many of you this coming September during National Recovery Month.
All right. Thanks, Ryan. Support Mobilize Recovery. Support Dopey Patreon. Buy gear on the fucking dopeypodcast.com. I just got 24 new style Big Bird or Big Bud snapbacks. Just 24. If you want them, message me on Instagram. It's $30 with stickers. Also at the dopeypodcast.com store, we have that Buddha stuff. The Buddha stuff is going to go out of print in a second. We might make a second run, but if you want yours, we are going to be shipping June 1st, so put in an order now. There's tons of other amazing stuff on there, and I have a ton of socks, a ton of stickers. You know, there's a lot of stuff out there. Anyway, enough with the fucking ads. Before I say here's the show, subscribe to YouTube. I appreciate everything you guys are doing. Go to the Dopey Nation Zoom. The Dopey Nation Zoom is posted on the Dopey Nation page on Facebook. I will post more schedules on the Dopey Nation Zoom on Instagram. Basically, it's a fellowship right there available every week, 25 meetings. They do AA, NA, NOA, Dharma, fucking smart recovery, a ton of stuff. Find your people. Go to Dopey Nation Zoom. Enough with the ads. Here's the fucking show. This one is incredibly dopey.
Hit these motherfuckers with some dopey, dude.
I love that dopey every day. I love to hear the next thing that Chris and Dave are gonna say. And yes, there's dopey. I used to be a junkie, but now I have some hopey because of those dopes down at Dopey.
Welcome to Dopey, the podcast on drugs, addiction, and other dumb shit. My name is Dave. I'm in Long Island with the return of Fentanyl J. Is this the one? No, it's this one. No, it's not that one. It's this one. Welcome back, Jay.
Fentanyl J.
And there's you got to get on the mic. What are you doing? What are you doing here? What are you doing?
I'm fucking up.
What's going on?
It's early, Dave.
He's fidgeting with the vape and some pieces of paper.
I'm not vaping in here though.
Why not?
Linda.
You can vape in here.
Oh, word?
It's a vape.
I'm fucking vaping in here, Linda.
I'm vaping.
I don't give a fuck.
So there's a woman at our meeting who loves Jay. She actually shared at a meeting that she had a dream that me and her were married and Jay was our child.
Love child.
And she doesn't want Jay to be called Fentanyl Jay. She wants Jay to be called Phenomenal Jay.
Oh, shout out. Shout out to K-Dot.
What do you think?
Shout out to K.
Do you want to be called Phenomenal Jay or Fentanyl Jay or just Jay?
I don't know. Fentanyl Jay was coined. You coined it a little bit.
I did. It was coined. Minted.
And not only that, I was recognized as Fentanyl Jay.
Now, hold up. Before we get into that, I just want to give a shout out to this weird company that aren't advertising. It's this weird health. Hold on for a second. I got to pause this. Jay always inspires me to shout people out because he's a big shout-out person. So we're going to give a shout-out to Garden Lights Veggies Made Great for the spinach egg white frittata. Fucking good.
Fire?
Fire frittata.
Fiery frittata.
I'm going to make you one before you go.
Please.
And then also shout-out to Fentanyl Jay for bringing a nice iced coffee.
Yeah, I did that.
Why don't you describe the beverage that you brought over?
This is actually, I wasn't even going to go venti, you know, but I got the Starbucks app. Shout-out to Starbucks. It's very.
You use the app too.
I use the app. You don't play. Heavily.
You did it at home. Like you're in bed. You're like, what am I going to get?
I'm heavily on the app. My points, my Starbucks points are fucking crazy. I can probably get a fucking mug.
Really?
Yeah.
So we're on the phone.
A mug or two.
Jay's like, hold on, I got ice in my mouth. People don't like that.
What?
You know what that is?
What?
When people, when I.
Using the app?
No, in the old days, I used to eat when we did the show, while we did the show. And people would write these things. I really love Chris on the show, but Dave is disgusting with the eating. And there's something called misophonia, which is like a horrible reaction to mouth sounds like eating or ice in the mouth.
But what about all the ASMR people, you know? You know what that is?
I do only because of my kid, but break it down.
So, like, people eat, like, carrots.
Yes.
Like, real close to the mic, real slow.
Who does that?
People.
I heard ASMR is more like waxy paper, like, fucking, like, crunkly shit.
Oh, that could be what ASMR is, but there's a subreddit of ASMR. Like a subcategory.
Look at you. Off social media, but deep in the ASMR subreddit?
Deep in the ASMR scene. People love hearing people eat carrots.
Wow.
And celery.
Really?
And, so as many people as are shy, what, mesophobia?
Misophonia.
Misophonia.
Misophonia or misophonia?
Phobia?
Phobia.
Phobia.
Right. Phobia or phonia?
So as many people as you're shunning with this misophonia.
I'm attracting somebody else. No way. It's all lip smacking, disgusting sounds. It's not the yummy carrot munching sound.
Well, maybe you have misophonia and I'm
ASMR.
ASMR.
So first I wanted to shout out the frittata. I was hungry. I came home. I made one. Unbelievably delicious. Unbelievably delicious. And I like saying the word frittata.
Frittata
as hard. Well.
Ooh. Pretty healthy, too.
Yeah, break it down.
Wow, very healthy.
Break it down.
Are you kidding?
Break it down, Jay.
This is crazy.
Just give it to the audience.
Wow, look at this ingredients, though. Vegetable blend of spinach, tomatoes, onions, red bell peppers, egg whites. What? Mozzarella. This is all real stuff.
And you want one after the show?
Yeah, I do. No added bullshit.
So you like this thing?
Yeah.
Okay, so
5 grams of protein. Gotta get your protein.
Maybe when we're done, we're gonna do a special Patreon episode of Jay tasting the frittata.
Sugar Ray. Yeah, wow. This is some healthy shit.
All right, now let's get back to the story. You're working.
Oh yeah.
Ray, and I keep saying fucking Ray.
Sugar Ray.
We were talking about Ray at the meeting.
Shout out to Sugar Ray.
But Ray Brown. Shout out to Ray Brown. Is a friend. And former sometime Dopey co-host who's in semi-retirement at the moment. We'll see if he comes back. Who knows? Give a shout out to Ray.
Shout out to Sugar Ray. Sugar Ray the goat.
Jay works at a restaurant called Dirty Taco.
Oh, shit. Shout out to Dirty Taco.
Break it down, Jay.
So I was working at the restaurant. And first thing that happens that day, my boy Vegan, shout out to Vegan, real name John. I don't even know his real name because I only call him Vegan.
Is his real name John?
Yes.
Okay.
Fucking
John the Vegan.
Super fucking like, bro, fucking my hair is really long. Fucking,
Vegan to the bone.
I shred the snowboard. I eat fucking grass and beans.
Fritatas.
Eats mad free. Is this vegan? Yeah.
No, it's not, because it's got eggs.
Whatever. It's vegan enough. Anytime I see him eating anything, I say, bro, that's not fucking vegan, bro. Yo, what are you doing? I'm about to call the V police. The
Does he eat non-vegan?
No, he's straight vegan. Like, bro, check him out. I don't even know his, I don't have social media, but he's literally a professional snowboarder. Backflip.
He's good.
Ridiculous.
See, when you described him to me, I didn't imagine somebody who'd be good.
He's broed out, dude. He surfs and skates and shreds. And his girl, shout out to his girl, I forgot your name, probably listening right now. She's a listener, avid listener. We gotta get her some merch for the
support. All right, just calm down.
Come on, bro.
Tell the story. You're ruining the whole fucking story.
I'm sorry. Oh, vegan, I'm at my job, comes up to me, and he goes, yo, I didn't know his girl was in recovery. I had no idea. His comes up, apparently she's been in recovery for a few years. Comes up to me and goes, yo, bro. I'm like, yo, what's up, vegan? he's like, bro, so my girl was fucking listening to this podcast. And I was like, oh shit, I know where this is going. Because, you know, no one really knows at my job. You know, I was a fucking rager, you know.
Rager is to put it very mildly.
Yeah, I was a fucking rager. So he fucking comes up to me and he goes, yo, bro, my girl's listening to this podcast. And then she saw this picture of you. It said Fentanyl J. And she goes, is this the kid I met at your job like last night? And I was like, oh shit, like deer in headlights at first. I was like, know what? Yeah.
No, but what you told me, you said vegan comes up to you and he's like, bro, are you Fentanyl J?
Yeah. Show me basically, is this you? And I was like, oh shit. But apparently his girl's an avid listener. Shout out to Vegan. Shout out to his girl. She's also an acupuncturist. One of those.
Yes.
And she's fucking, that fits him. I mean, he would be with a, and she's older than him. He's my age. She's probably like 40 or
Wasn't
something.
Wasn't there someone else that yes. came in too?
And then the same fucking day, not even, maybe a few hours later, the same fucking day, I'm fucking waiting tables like a fucking slave to the fucking world that I am. Conforming to society and
nice.
Working
one table at a time.
Yeah. Yeah. And I'm waiting this table and this girl, I think her name is Mallory. I forget. Shout out to you, Mallory. If you're listening, has the phone out with a picture of you and me. And she goes, is this you? I said, oh shit. She says, are you fentanyl? That's the one that said, like, are you fentanyl J? I was like,
what'd you say?
I was like, I guess
maybe,
I am.
Maybe I am.
Who's asking?
Maybe I'm just phenomenal J. Yeah. Fucking, I swear to God.
Twice in a day.
Jay told me that story.
In hours.
I've done the show 6.5 years. 6.5 years. It's never happened. I've worn dopey gear in the city. I've gone to fucking Narcotics Anonymous meetings hoping to flash the dopey card. Nobody fucking knows. He comes on the show twice. Two people in the middle of Patchogue are like, are you Fentanyl Jay?
Yep.
That's a big deal, Jay.
Yep.
That's no joke.
No joke.
Am I hitting the right button? There you go. That's fucking, I love that. And it's also like, I don't deserve... Listen, I crave the dopey fame. I don't deserve it. I'm happy that you get the dopey fame. I love all that shit.
Oh, no, but you have the dopey fame. She would love to meet you.
Oh, stop it.
She would love to meet you, Dave.
All right, one day.
She wants to meet you, Dave.
Meet me at DopeyCon. October 1st.
I told them.
Really?
Yep.
That's what I'm talking
They're
about.
They're in there.
And if you want to come to DopeyCon,
I told them.
You know who else is going to come to DopeyCon? I don't know if you know this guy. He's a legendary skateboarder and felon and horrible drug addict.
Hell yeah.
Andy Roy. Fucking,
yeah, fuck. He'll Andy be at, fucking Roy.
Yeah, he's going to be at DopeyCon.
No way.
Fucking Novak's going to be at DopeyCon.
What's his fucking... He had this show that I used to watch. They all skateboarded.
Rip Ride.
Fucking, no.
Oh, fucking, no. I know what you're talking about. I don't remember what it's called.
Street King some
yeah,
shit.
Yeah, he's crazy.
Yeah, he's a... Shout out to Andy Roy.
So
bro.
He'll be at DopeyCon.
He's going to be at DopeyCon.
Smiling Joe will be at DopeyCon. Fucking Aaron Carr will be at DopeyCon. The list is just getting longer. I'm thinking about camping out in front of Artie Lang's house and petitioning Artie to make his return at DopeyCon. It's probably not a good idea.
Wow, though. Andy Roy's going to be there too. And you said Brian Novak?
Brandon Novak. Maybe his brother Brian will be there too. Maybe both the Novak
Jackass
brothers.
Jackass dudes.
Yeah. But so bro, yeah, what? DopeyCon October 1st. Get your tickets. Oh, we also have a theater. The theater is intact.
I don't know. Andy Roy's got no teeth?
Look, dude's your butt. No, he's got new teeth.
Does he?
He's got big pearly whites.
Oh, okay. dude's a savage.
So it looks like we have a theater on 42nd Street. It's called New Playwrights Horizon. Fits 200 people. We're going to cater it from Katz's. It's fucking going down. I think you need to be vaccinated, though. Are you vaccinated?
Max to the max.
You need to be vaccinated for this thing. And if that's a problem, get a vax card, fake it, write an email to dopeypodcast@gmail.com.
Fake vax to the
max. I think Jay could probably fake a vax card for you if you need it fake. Done. Please, we want you at DopeyCon. Don't really fake your vax card. I don't want
to
be.
Unless you have to.
Unless you have to. Unless it's like violating religious beliefs or something fundamentally important to you.
Fake that.
So yeah, Andy Roy's show is King of the Road.
King of the Road. Yeah, it was close.
And we don't know if Brian Novak's going to make it, but Brandon will be there. Supposedly.
Look at fucking Andy's
come.
Picture on his Instagram.
Let me see.
He's a savage.
Oh yeah, he's great. He's great. So you want to hear a funny story?
Yeah.
So fucking, I'm going to Katz's, right? And I get to the door, and in the front of Katz's, there's a guy who kind of hands out tickets there. He's like the door guy. And he goes, David, this thing arrived for you. And I was like, what, you know, what could possibly have arrived for me? And he goes, I think it's for the bathroom. And I'm like, what? And, gives me this big Amazon box. And I open it up, and in the Amazon box is a motorized toilet brush. And years ago, when we recorded the show at Chris's family's house in the Hamptons, Chris had crazy money. And one day I was like going off on his family having so much money. I was like, how could you say your family's not crazy rich when they have this motorized toilet brush?
Clearly, fuck you money.
I know, that's fuck you toilet brush
a
money.
Motor in their toilet brush.
Well, it's serious business.
I don't even have a fucking toilet brush.
you want the motorized one? I'll give it if you want it. I'll give it to
sick.
You. So somebody in the Dopey Nation sent it to me at Katz's because they must have heard that. And which I really appreciate. So if it was you, write me an email at dopeypodcast@gmail.com and I'll send you some merch. And if you want Dopey merch, there's all sorts of new shit coming out. The Dopey Buddha is about to be done. So if you want the Dopey Buddha, the first shipping of Dopey Buddha is going to happen on June 1st. So if get your orders in before June 1st and that'll come. We got the long sleeve, the tank top, the fucking t-shirt. It's
Dopey
nice.
Dopey Buddha?
Dopey Buddha. And then the next design is
dope.
The next design is pretty fiery. The next design is pretty fiery, so look for that. Get all the Dopey merch at dopeypodcast.com. Unfortunately, I have like fucking 40 pairs of Dopey socks upstairs.
Love
so
those.
Either send in a voicemail and I'll read it and I'll give you some fucking socks, or just Venmo me $15.
Can't beat that.
They're also on sale at DopeyCon. So come to DopeyCon. They'll probably
socks
be socks.
Fire.
The socks are comfy.
The socks are fire.
Right? You
those
still
are
have yours?
Socks. Yeah, I wear the, those are like my socks.
All right, well, there you go.
My go-tos.
So then I'm fucking, I don't know, on the train home and somebody writes me, what Dopey episodes would you recommend? And like, I always recommend kind of the same ones, like from the early days, because I have a soft spot for them. And I said, oh, you know which show I really liked? It was the show where I talked about, like, I had moved from Manhattan to Sayville, and I had to sell my couch. Like this, and it was disgusting, old couch, you know, and I always loved the
we
story
buy that.
Because it was also like the couch that we recorded 100 episodes of
the
show the on.
Dopey couch.
Yeah.
Oh, and that just jacks the price of merch.
But
I'm
it was like I shot a shitload of heroin on the couch.
Oh,
I masturbated an infinite number of times
that
on
couch
that couch.
Has got history.
Burned, stained, everything.
Hell,
and I was
yeah.
like, and I was like, dude, listen to the Dopey couch episode.
Mm.
And then he was like, well, where is it? And I was like, I'm not even sure. So I started looking for it and I found it. And I listened to it, and it was the same episode with the motorized toilet brush.
No.
Is it odd or is it Todd? Right? I don't know.
Big T, little odd.
I know. Unbelievable.
Wow.
Unbelievable.
I want to hear that one.
You do? It's not. And then I listened to it. It wasn't as good as I thought.
Still.
I'll send you
did
a link.
Did the couch go?
Oh, dude, this beautiful, like the best looking couple I've ever seen in my life, straight off the boat from Ireland, bought the couch.
No.
And like the whole time, it's, listen to the episode. but so like, basically the dude, I'm like, I'm just trying not to tell them about Dopey, about anything. You know, I don't want them to know everything, but I can't help it because it seems so special to me that these people are going to own the Dopey couch. And in the end, I think I did tell them.
You had to have.
Yeah, but I think I got $400 for it.
Not bad.
I know.
Not bad. You think you'd do better now. You know, that couch is...
That's interesting. It's like, what from Dopey will actually be worth something in the future?
There's a fucking sign upstairs.
The neon sign?
Yeah.
You think that's going to be worth something in the future?
Some weight.
Well, we'll see.
It's a nice one.
I got an email. You want to hear an email?
Let's hear it.
All right, here we go. Hi, Dave. First off, I love your podcast. Truly amazing. Please don't use my last name on the podcast if you happen to read the email. Thank you. I heard your request for PCP stories. I have one that features Andy Dick. You know that Andy Dick is an on-again, off-again show guy.
Yeah.
Okay. He's like one of the more polarizing guests. And he also just got arrested for sexually assaulting somebody in California, which is like his fifth offense.
Okay. Shout out to Andy Dick.
I know. All right. Very nice. I have one that features Andy Dick. It happened about 24 years ago in Los Angeles, where I still live. I don't know if you can say his name or associate him with the story, but this is all true. Here goes. My best friend and I were out at a restaurant called Pino Hollywood. We worked for talent agents at a talent and literary agency, and we represented several actors on the show, on the show's news radio and Everyone Loves Raymond. It was tape night, Friday night, and the actors on those two shows and their agents and managers would go out to Pino Hollywood after the shows finished taping every week. The restaurant was full of actors, producers, agents, managers, etc., and jam-packed with all sorts of people. We were sitting at a table drinking our Cosmopolitans, and suddenly Andy Dick, who was sitting right next to us, pulled out his weed pipe. He just lit it up in the middle of the restaurant inside like it was no biggie. Again, this was 24 years ago and weed wasn't legal. We were on an outdoor patio, and we weren't on an outdoor patio. We were inside the restaurant.
Hell yeah.
Anyway, Andy offers the pipe to me and said, this is funny to me. I didn't read this before. And said, this stuff is from Dennis Hopper's weed dealer, which both intrigued me and scared me a bit. Jokingly, as I took a hit, I said, it's not laced with PCP, right? Ha ha ha. Andy just giggled. I had been smoking pot very regularly since I was 13 and loved some good weed. My friend, who didn't smoke weed a lot but has never found a drug she didn't like, took a hit too. We were living the Hollywood dream. Crazy 25-year-olds working in the entertainment industry having a blast on a Friday night. We both took 3 or 4 hits. It tasted a bit off.
Oof.
Yeah. Immediately after the first hit, I felt different. More different than I've ever felt before. Not good different. Just different. About 3 minutes after the last hit, my friend... Can you imagine Andy Dick just sitting there? Right?
Giggling.
Yeah. After about 3 minutes after the last hit, my friend and I looked at each other and conveyed, holy shit, what have we done with our eyes? Meanwhile, Andy appeared totally normal. Well, as normal as Andy Dick can appear. I absolutely love Andy, by the way. I do too. I needed to get out of that restaurant ASAP, but I needed to puke more than I've ever needed to before. We ran to the bathroom and both puked for about 10 minutes nonstop, like violent, intense puking. Sorry that's so disgusting, but it's true. I was more fucked up than I've ever been, and I've done every drug on the planet except for PCP until that night. I felt like I had cement blocks on my feet, similar to how Special K ketamine makes you feel, but I also couldn't function or think or speak, and I couldn't move normally. Mm. People looked scary as fuck. We were so fucked up, Dave. It was not pleasant or enjoyable in any way.
Tricked into PCP.
We got into my friend's car. I don't know how she drove, holy shit, and thought a trip to Burger King would help absorb the poisons in our system. We both ate a burger, drank a giant soda, then promptly had to pull over so we could puke our brains out again. She eventually dropped me off at home, and I crawled up the stairs and continued puking for a few more hours.
Damn.
Unfortunately, I had to go to the Lilith Fair concert the next morning after a night of PCP-induced illness and debauchery. It was hell on earth being at that concert. I'm not sure. I'm 100% sure that weed was laced with angel dust / PCP. I've never experienced anything like it and hope not to again. It was wild. Thanks for all you do. Toodles for Chris, Tracy. P.S. What the hell were we thinking getting high with Andy Dick in the middle of a restaurant in front of our bosses? We didn't even get in trouble, and no one mentioned this when we went back to work on Monday. That's the entertainment industry for you.
True. How can you not get high with Andy Dick in the middle of a restaurant?
Do you have any PCP stories?
I do. I do.
All right, let's hear it.
I only smoked it once as well. I didn't violently puke, but I definitely don't.
Where were you?
I was in California as well. I was in Hollywood.
Were you with Andy Dick?
What? No.
Was Andy Dick sexually assaulting you during it?
Clearly not as glorious as yours. Tracy's in the middle of a restaurant. I was in the middle of the Momo.
What's the Momo?
Like the motel, hotel.
Okay.
If you're in LA, you definitely know it. It's a shithole. It's what the biggest shithole in Hollywood. It's right at the end of the boulevard.
The purple one?
7-star hotel, I think that's what it's called.
Okay.
Shithole. Like, okay. Filled with fucking
degenerates. Like you.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. I was blending right in.
You weren't the only Fentanyl J at that Momo.
I was not. I was a good Christian compared to the others over there. I smoked that shit. And is this Dopey? Where I guess I fucking had an orgy.
All right, here we go.
I had a fucking orgy. I was with this girl, Kate.
Shout out to Kate.
With this other dude from Jersey who was fucking a rager, literally a rager.
Was it Mike the Situation from the Jersey Shore?
I wish, yeah. He turned into Mike the Situation after hit of this shit. Bro, this shit, I never did it again either. Tracy, I feel your pain. I feel you. It was a cigarette. They did the fucking cigarette.
They dipped into
the wet.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. So, first.
It was the formaldehyde or was the straight PCP?
I have no fucking idea. Okay. Have you done it before?
No.
No?
No.
You know about it.
Well, I've been very intrigued by it. And Chris had never done it either. So that was something we always talked about.
Well, the same thing happened to this girl. She was kind of tricked into it. I was like, whatever. We were fucking running together. Like,
I need to know where the orgy comes from.
So. This kid from Jersey is with these girls like lived at this hotel. Like this girl lived there and she's so
Kate.
No. Kate was with me. But this guy and these two girls like lived at this hotel. Like literally, you know, like all their shit was in the
it was like residential business.
Yeah, but like it was a shitty
hotel. They paid by the month or
yeah,
something.
Yeah, but it was a shitty hotel. And they sold a lot of drugs out of there. And at first, you know, shit was getting weird. We were all getting high and shit. We were all doing fucked up shit. But this girl, this kid, I don't even, not even gonna say his name. You wouldn't know him, but he was on my fourth step. Fuck that guy.
Okay.
So he fucking passes around a fucking cigarette to the other girls. And she's like, why are you passing around a cigarette? Like, it's fucking weird. You know, she had no idea. And she hits it. And she's like, a couple minutes later, yo, what the fuck was that? And then he goes, oh, that was fucking, you know, you just smoked wet. That's what he said. You smoked wet. I was like, word? She smoked wet and I didn't get to smoke wet? You know, now I'm jealous. Fucking.
Because you had seen Training Day?
What? Training Day, yeah, classic.
Yeah.
So I fucking smoked it and bro, oh, here's what it's like. It's like, to me, being drunk on a Xanax, injecting ketamine, the little sprinkle of acid.
Wow.
That's
a crazy combination.
That's
it's powerful.
That's
right?
That's what it was.
Now I want, how did the orgy commence? Like, where did they come from?
So we were at the one girl's place, right? And then there's three girls in total, me and this kid, right? We're at this one girl's place downstairs, and out of nowhere, fucking Kate and the other girl go back to her room to bake cookies. Weird. Just a weird.
Was that really their plan?
I have no idea. None.
Is that like a euphemism for orgying? Have you been in a lot of orgies?
I've been in a handful.
I had a feeling. Does anyone ever say baked cookies like that?
Never.
Okay.
Never.
Okay.
Never have I ever. Also, they went to bake cookies. And it was weird because like now we're just hanging out. I'm fucking zooted. I'm gone. And we're doing various drugs and I'm gone, right? And before we know it, like, yo, like, where are these girls? Like, they were supposed to bake cookies. So we go back there together.
You and the Jersey guy me, and the guy in the fourth step?
And the girl. No, the Jersey guy is a guy in the fourth step. So me, him, and this other girl go back to where Kate and the other girl went to bake cookies. And we go back there and they're making out. Like, just making out, right? And we look at each other like, oh, shit. Like, is this happening? Is this going down,
right,
bro?
Right.
Is this going? And, dude, two out of three were pretty hot. You know, the one that stayed back with us.
Not so much.
Guys with the award, you know, just like it's going down. Take one for the team, whatever. So they're making out and we're like, oh, shit. Like we looked at each other like, oh, shit. Like, is this about.
This is an opportunity.
Is this going to happen right now?
It was.
But it happened before we knew it. There's fucking this over going in there. It was fucking who's he, what's he, and what's who's over there. I saw his dick multiple times, you know.
Did it ever get near you?
Close proximity.
How close did it get to you?
Like, oh, this is fucking embarrassing. All right, so fucking girls, back to back. Like, pretend you're spooning, but you're flipped back to back. Right? Instead of, like, hugging from the back, you're both on your back.
I get you.
We could have grazed balls because we're both having sex with girls that are back to back. We could have grazed balls.
Is that anywhere in your mind?
Nowhere.
And when you saw it, did it flash in your head?
And I was like, this is weird.
And you're like, eyes off
this
there.
This just happened. This
stay
happened.
In the
and
game.
I've never thought about that. stay focused.
In other orgies,
yeah.
Were there dicks in proximity?
So I've never had like raging orgies. I've had orgies with like only another guy and like two or more girls.
Hold on, say that again.
Like,
I got distracted.
Thinking about balls.
I was thinking about my one close, my one experience
close
that was nothing.
With a dick.
It was nothing like yours. But tell me yours.
So like, I've never had orgies with multiple dudes.
Good.
So it's always one other dude, and like,
as many women
two
as you
or
could
more
deal.
Chicks. Okay. Yeah. I've had fucking. Six. That's the limit. Six.
Four women
two
and two
dudes,
guys.
Four
wow,
chicks.
That's crazy. But that's probably at the height of your dealing.
Yeah,
the height
all
of,
the way up.
Right.
Yeah. We were fucking doing.
Where
doing
was that?
That was in the loft in Los Angeles. That was intense. I was on many drugs. That was intense.
How did that one happen?
That was my homeboy. Shout out to Ryan.
How did that even happen? He set it up?
What?
How did that even happen?
I was like throwing like a fucking drug dealer party at my house, kind of like with my homeboys, bunch of girls. That's when I was selling like a lot of coke too, like getting a lot of coke. And that's like a big, you know, party.
Orgy drug.
Yeah, orgy drug for sure. And we were just throwing a party. And before I knew it, there was just me and him and those four. That wasn't even a party. It seemed like a party looking back. But yeah, it was just me and him, those four girls. And we were fucking partying. It wasn't like a party.
Was that
we
the idea? Was the plan?
I don't know.
Was the plan, Ryan, we're going to get four girls here and we're going to orgy?
I don't think so. I think he, it might have been his plan. You know, it
could have
been.
And they're
his
like,
plan.
Let's bake some cookies.
Before you know it, we're fucking dicks flying around.
Jay, I need to applaud you and thank you. Oh, I mean, because I think that's the first dopey orgy story.
Is it?
I mean, Chris told a story about masturbating in front of a skinhead. That didn't go well.
Sick.
And I don't think I've told many, many stories like that. One time I mean, my closest thing to an orgy story was I wasn't even on drugs. I was like high. I was like high on weed and working for a TV company in East Lansing, Michigan. And somehow I hooked up with two women in a house, but I wasn't really, I wasn't attracted to either of them. And I was like,
up to a solid score.
I think I put them together.
Two fours is the name.
No, but I don't think anything happened. I think I put them together and I like passed out. Like I don't, my orgy story is not an orgy story, but,
it reminded me though, like one time I was with that girl, Kate, and I fucking broke the tip off the pin and fucking shot meth in her butt.
Hold on, what?
Yeah, that reminded me of that. I don't know why. I was thinking of this girl, Kate. Have you ever, because I was thinking about when we were doing coke and how you like blow it in someone's ass with a straw.
I never did that either.
No?
Hold on. So what? How would you blow coke in someone's ass?
You get a straw, you dip it, like scoop it like a pixie stick.
See, you've had real, I mean, like you're taking this thing to another level. This is why Karen calls you Phenomenal Jay. She must have heard the blowing coke in the asshole story.
People know me on here too. Wow, I'm such a scumbag. It's all right.
This is good.
Shout out to me for being a scumbag.
Hold on. So you and Kate, coke in the... So did,
that was what were we were doing.
Was Kate blowing coke up your butthole too?
No, no.
Never happened? Who did you let blow coke up your butthole? No. Kate? So why'd you say no when it was yes?
I lied.
Wow. So how is that compared?
Wow, this is embarrassing.
How is snorting coke versus smoking coke?
Coke's not very different.
How about meth in the butt?
Meth in the butt's different.
Lots of people talk about meth in the butt.
Meth in the butt is different. Also, ew. Okay.
Hold on. Is meth in the butt preferable to shooting meth?
I don't like shooting meth.
Okay. Keep going.
But I don't like smoking meth either. I don't like
meth. You just like meth in the butt. You'll take it in the butt.
Bro, this is so embarrassing. Oh, shit. Okay. So, first of all, first things first. My biggest...
First things first, I'm grateful to be here. I'm grateful to be sober.
What's happening? Bro, so first things first, I am fucking... Like, my biggest turnoff from a chick on this... I know this is not fair or whatever, and I don't care, but my biggest turnoff is, like, thinking of, like, a really hot girl... Just taking like a massive nasty shit, right?
See, that turns me on. I don't know.
Bro, so it's like I was with this chick for 6 years. She never shit once ever. We went on vacation for like weeks at a time.
Did you tell her? You're like, listen, before we get together, I need to have some ground rules.
No. But she never shit once. That's why I love her. But this after I shot meth in this girl's butt, bro.
It exploded with shit on your face?
No.
What happened?
Bro, after... And meth affects a lot of everyone differently. Like, so I feel like the people that love meth are like... Their bodies are pre-distinguished, whatever.
It's a different brain chemistry and body chemistry.
Exactly. So some people like fucking say they shoot it and ejaculate. Like, have you heard that?
Sure.
Yeah.
Yes. I never had that.
Never
experience.
Happened to me. No. I fucking get crazy. All right.
So, I get crazy. Yeah, exactly. I get uncomfortable. Yeah,
very uncomfortable. Yeah. Me as well. Yeah. Me as well. So fucking, this girl was just like a freak when she did meth, right? So it was her idea. I've got pictures on my phone. I'll show you them later. It's okay. Fucked up. Like, syringe in the butt, fucking top.
Yeah. No, you don't.
I swear to God, I'm gonna find him right now.
No, just keep going.
I'm gonna keep going anyway. But bro, fucking. So this chick, after we fucking did the meth in the butt, did it in my. She fucking, bro. She took the nastiest fucking shit, bro.
In front of you?
No, I walked in after, and it was rancid. I said.
Our relationship's over.
You have to go. I'm not kidding.
You broke up with her?
I said you have to leave.
Like, wow. That was it?
No. We reconciled.
That was the end of the relationship. That was enough. Oh, wow.
To fucking, bro. Oh,
I would love to hear how ladies in the Dopey Nation feel
know,
about this,
this
story.
I know. This is very unfair. I'm a scumbag.
Listen. Doe, hold on.
Do you see that?
So you squirt it in there? So you take the needle off. And you squirt the coke and water solution meth. Into her asshole. Oh, the meth. This is pretty spicy. That's a spicy picture.
Tied.
Wow. That's a serious fucking picture right there.
Serious
I'm picture. Glad you held on to this. And that was just 3 years ago.
Yeah. Yeah.
And it was this day. This very day, 3 years ago.
Shut the fuck up.
Holy cow.
Wow.
Is it odd or is it Todd?
Wow.
Wow.
That bananas. Is fucking crazy.
Bananas. Well, Fentanyl J, you've taken it to another level.
That is fucking crazy.
It really is. It's like the craziest. It's also like your life went to total hell. You orgied like a fucking rock star. Then you fucking bottomed out like a horrible fentanyl dealer.
Yeah.
And now... You're like living the life a person in recovery. I mean, and I'm not trying to be schmaltzy with my recovery, but lay it down for a second. Before we go into, we have a really fiery guest, Jed from Church and Other Drugs, who has been friends with the show forever. He dropped some fucking serious dopey.
He did.
But before we get to Jed.
Shout out to Jed.
I just want you to make it clear, like when you go over this, right? Mm. You're fucking... Getting PCP injected into your... I'm sorry, getting meth injected into your ass, injecting this spicy young woman as well, tying her up, white lace.
That's a crazy picture.
Yeah, it's serious business. Now, how does
your... Hands are tied to the feet.
How does your brain comprehend all of this sitting here with 8.5 months clean?
I mean...
Break it down.
I mean, I've realized at times when I... Because I take a lot of shit for granted, and I'm not very good at fucking... I'm not very good at being grateful, as we know. I'm not very good at being grateful. I take a lot of shit for granted. But there are some.
But do you think that is? Do you think that it's because you don't think you deserve grace?
It's possible. It's probable because, like, I think subconsciously I do feel like that, you know, because like I fucking, you know, we've done all done bad, you know, so it's like, where are, you know, are you deserving of feeling? But there are some times when I look back, I'm like, you know what, I've came a long way.
Absolutely. Like, hold on.
Press the right one.
Shout out to Fentanyl Jack. Yeah. Dude, you've come a long way.
I've
and
a
like
long way. I haven't fucking smoked fentanyl
or sold it
in like a year almost, you know, about a year. Which is crazy because that's all I haven't sold drugs in a year. I haven't done drugs in a year. And that's all I've done for 27 years.
All right.
Or whatever, 10. Whatever.
Well, how does it make you 15. Feel saying that on the greatest show on drugs, addiction, and dumb shit? Saying that.
Greatest show, period.
All right. Just you don't listen to anything, including Dopey. But so now just say
greatest host.
How does it make you feel?
A little accomplished. It does. Listen, makes me feel accomplished.
I'm fucking proud of you.
Thanks.
That's it. That's all I have to say. Now, before we get to Jed, I was going to say Fentanyl Jed. Before we get to Jed from Church and Other Drugs, real quick, I need to say that this episode of Dopey is brought to you by BetterHelp.com. Do you ever feel burned out, Jay?
Beginning to not quite yet.
Are you working too much? Maybe not taking enough time for yourself?
Burning from both ends with work a little bit, but I fucking need to do something, you know.
For if me, I just have to say this. For me, therapy has been a game changer. I had my friend Sam was producing Dopey for years. I talked to him every day for hours a day. He quit in December. As soon as he quit, I was like, fuck, I need to get into therapy. And therapy has been really, really helpful. BetterHelp.com offers online therapy. It is customized online therapy that offers video, phone, and even live chat sessions with your therapist. So you don't have to see anyone on camera. They don't have to know about the fucking meth in the butt.
Major key.
They don't have to see the picture.
Major key.
It's much more affordable than in-person therapy, and you can be matched with a therapist in under 48 hours. Our listeners get 10% off their first month at BetterHelp.com/DopeyPodcast. That's BetterHelp.com/DopeyPodcast. If you want in on this BetterHelp, that's the fucking discount.
I need some BetterHelp.
All right. Now, here's Jed from Church and Other Drugs. And Jay, you're kicking the fire, and I'm proud of you. You're doing good.
Thanks, Steve.
You should feel good.
Baby Jones.
All right, here we go. We do a new thing called Behind the Dope, but this is really like welcome back Jed to Dopey. Jed is an important figure in the pantheon of Dopey history. Jed was a Dopey listener who had the idea for Dopey before we did, sent in an angry email saying how he had the idea before Chris and I, told a crazy story about robbing people at a hotel, then started his own podcast called Church and Other Drugs. Welcome back to the show, Jed.
Hey, how's it going, Dave?
Dude, check this out. You ready? You can't see it easy, but check this out. On the wall.
Hey!
Jed painted this for our 100th episode. Jed is a very prodigious musician and artist. And this is, if you're not watching this, it is a picture of Dopey the Dwarf snorting up 100 of, I assume it was cocaine.
Cocaine. This was before fentanyl.
Before fentanyl and before Chris died, you painted that.
Yeah. Jeez.
A lot of history.
This is now my second anger thing, because at least for the longest time, I was like, well, my audio at least sounds better. At least I got that going for you. And then now, like I said, I log into this and you've got this crazy pro rig now. So you're just fully ahead of the game.
I'm vested and invested, but also incredibly grateful and happy to have you on because I love you and you know, you've been a part of this thing. I mean, like, I also always reflect on the first time we recorded together, which was many years ago, and Chris got a fancy hotel room, and we did a Church and Other Drugs episode and a Dopey episode at the same time, which was probably not a strategic thing to do, right?
No, no, because it's like you're just going to listen to one or the other.
We should have done two episodes, you know, so yes. We each had an exclusive, but we couldn't think about it, right?
And I lost my audio because I went back and re-listened to it, and my audio didn't work, so I had to end up getting you to send ours. So on my episode, my audio was the shittier one. But what are you going to do? Yeah, that was like five years ago?
Like 5.5 years ago.
God. Yeah, it is. This is like, as much as I gripe about the internet ruining our lives and everything, this is the podcasting, like, it's extremely surreal that our relationship is what it is, right? It's a very bizarre thing that happened, you know, because it's like we're legitimately like friends and totally know intimate things about each other's lives. It's just it's a crazy, crazy thing.
Well, it's cool. It's like, for all the disconnect from screen culture, there's also an ability to have an actual connect. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. Everyone talks about like being disconnect. Like my daughter, like fucking like this morning, there's someone's planning a surprise party for her 12-year-old friend, and that she's in this group text with 50 12-year-olds, and she can't like look up from her phone, and nothing's happening. And like, I feel her like going away because of the phone and this, but at the same time, things like, I mean, when Chris died, you and I talked for like days, you know, and we've always kind of been around each other over the years. And it's because of technology. So I agree with you. It's weird.
Yeah.
And why don't you break down, you know, you're a prodigious drug addict. And anybody that is unfamiliar with your drug history, why don't you give them a little Reader's Digest?
Reader's Digest. So I came up in the pre-internet, but back when Arrowwood.org was a huge thing, and like the Hive and Lyceum. I say that because like I grew up in a pretty strict Christian household. So I got busted smoking weed when I was 12, and they started drug testing me. So I hopped on Arrowwood and found things that wouldn't show up in a drug test. And that's when I ran into like Coricidin, cough and cold, and Benadryl and nutmeg and all that crazy shit. So I feel like there could have been two different versions of my drug use. One where like I smoke weed and drank like normal people, and it maybe would have lasted longer. But my version, I started, you know, 10th grade in high school, I'm blasted on DXM like every day at school, and just getting way, way more messed up than other people my age. And so like did cocaine when I was on my 15th birthday. By the time I was 17, it had gotten bad enough that my parents were sending me to an inpatient rehab. So
hold on though, to be blasted on DXM, how much DXM do you have to consume? What does that look like? And what, I've never been blasted on DXM. Can you paint us a picture?
For sure. So DXM, PCP, and ketamine, those are all sister chemicals, right? They're dissociative anesthetics. So that you measure the level by plateaus. There's first, second, third, and fourth plateau. Fourth is like you are one with the universe. You are no longer connected to your body. Third is like you can still kind of figure out who you are, but you're gone. So I guess it's like, I don't know the milligrams, but you're taking two packs of Coricidin. There's 16 pills in each pack. So you're taking, what's 16 times 2? I'm in college 32, algebra, and I don't know
32.
That. 32. That's the magic number. Right, you're taking,
yes.
There you go. You're taking 32 Coricidin pills in a trip. So that's where you get blasted. And I'm talking,
where do you get Coricidin pills?
We stole them. All right, so our group stole so many core seed and pills from our local Walmart, Walgreens, and CVS that because of us, they started putting security tags inside of them. So the generation under us started getting busted for stealing them.
I never even heard of chorocetin pills for some reason. I feel like I don't even know that, like, I feel like
triple C's, man. Triple C's. That was the name for them. It was just because, you know, you could get DX. Now you can just order straight DXM, pure DXM off of Amazon, because I guess they figured it out. But, you know, it's in, like, Robitussin, but then you're dealing with a whole bunch of other shit that makes you really sick when you eat or drink tons of it. Chorocetin had the least amount of other stuff and the highest amount of dextromethorphan in it.
So when you're taking 32 chorocetin pills and you're going to school, and you're a kid, how fucked up are you?
So fucked up that my 10th grade geometry teacher actually wrote me a letter saying, like, when you started this year, you were so bright, kind, and generous, and by the end of the year, you were a different person. I just don't know. She didn't know what I was on drugs, but she thought like I was getting beaten at home or something.
Right.
Like,
there was something like, happening. Something yes, bad was
you can't,
happening.
Like, you can't talk, really. You can't talk correctly. You do the robo walk, as they call it, because you can't really feel your extremities very well. So you kind of walk in a very, like, peculiar way. Your vision's cloudy. Your whole skin is numb. And then as far as, like, your mind and processing things, it's not going very well. This is where, like, signs I knew that I used differently than other people, because my thing is I would get on DXM and we would watch Requiem for a Dream over and over and over and over. Like, that was our trip movie to watch. And, like, that's not a pleasant, this isn't, you know, Wizard of Oz and dark. Right. No, it's not a good time, but I thought it was. And I'd listen to Radiohead and it was just dark, dark times. So things got so bad. Got into, like, ecstasy really hard back then. Cocaine.
Well, one of my favorite things is when Jet and I talk, he talks about, can I talk about your book for a second? Your plan for a
book?
Yeah,
for sure. Oh, so yeah, Jet, yeah, yeah, for sure.
Jet has this plan for a book where every chapter of the book is his experience with the substance. And now you're kind of laying out a lot of the history. So, like, when did you get into ecstasy?
That would have been 16, wow. 17.
And you come from, yeah, like a pretty, like, upright middle class Christian,
yeah,
home.
Yeah.
What, yep, were your parents, yep, doing when you're all fucking CC, you know, DXM'd out and fucking on ecstasy?
It was,
and how about just watching Requiem for a Dream? Did your mom ever walk in and be like, "What the fuck is going on?"
So I would do it all at night. So I had a sister that was 3 years older than me, and she was going through her rebellious stage. I was already labeled as, like, the good kid, so they weren't worried about me, right? So I was just really sneaky. And I was still, like, I was a youth group kid at my church, and I was just going to, God, I remember one time I had taken a bunch of chorocetin, we had drank some beer, smoked some weed, and I go into youth group church, and I open the door, 60 people in there just yell out surprise, and my mom had organized a surprise birthday party for me at church.
Oh my God.
And I just get, oh bro, I just get ambushed while I am fucked up, dude. It was, and then another time I remember I came home, I would just do it all at night, right? My parents were asleep. They started getting hip to it eventually, and I was on a bunch of ecstasy. I came home. Back then, we had one computer that was in the kitchen, you know, the family computer. And so it's, you know, 1 a.m, all the lights in the house are off. I'm on the computer, headphones on, listening to music or something. And I I look over and I see my mom there. And I was like, oh, like, how long has she been standing there? And I take my headphones off because she's talking to me. And she's like, what are you chewing on? And I was like, what? And I realized that I was just, you know, gnashing my teeth, grinding. Right. And she'd probably just been standing there like, what is my poor son on? And then I also, so the reason I started going to treatment about my parents finding out was I had my first overdose when I was 15 on Benadryl, which diphenhydramine is the only hallucinogen I've ever done. Well, it's a deliriant where I've seen things like as clear as I'm seeing you that were not there, like talking to people that aren't there, seeing things
on
that
Benadryl?
Aren't there. On Benadryl.
How much Benadryl?
I ended up taking like 43 of them.
Right.
Because, so what happened was I had a friend spend the night. He told me this. He told me that he woke up and we had bunk beds. He woke up in the middle of the night. He's on the top bunk. I'm standing over like head to head with him, jingling my keys, just looking at him, and he wakes up and goes, Jed, what time is it? And he said, I grabbed the clock, pulled it, unplugged it from the wall, looked at it, and said, 3:92. And then I went to the living
What's
room.
What's 3:92?
I don't know. That's just, this is the story that was told to me, and I love that, 3:92. And I go to the living room couch, and I'm sitting on the couch with my backpack on, boxers, socks and shoes, nothing else, rocking back and forth. And my dad comes into the room and says, what are you doing? And I say, I'm getting ready for school. And he goes, do you know, he's like, where's your friend? I was like, oh, he went home. And he's like, then why is his car still here? And he goes, do you know what day it is? And it was Sunday morning and they were getting ready for church. Yes, dude. So they took me straight to the hospital and he said, what did you take? And he told me, I looked at him and had a bottle of Benadryl and I just shook it and it was empty. And he was like, oh my God. So he took me to the hospital and that's how I started going into, I went to an outpatient for adolescence when I was 15.
When was the first time he caught you high in the first place?
So I had gone to the beach. I
can't believe we've never talked about this on the show before, by the way.
I know. Yeah, I guess you never really have heard all this. And this is the crazier shit. So I had started. The first thing I did was smoking cigarettes with a preacher's kid. And I had him on my second episode because he started all of this, really. It's hilarious. Yeah.
The origin story.
So I had these little cowboy boots from when I was a child, and I kept them in my closet, and my dad always said it was painfully ironic because it like represented my innocence or whatever, but that was my stash spot. So I kept my cigarettes and I had some weed in there, and one weekend I went to the beach, and I guess my parents had started getting suspicious because while I was gone they searched my room and they found it. There you go.
And they figured it out. So by the time you ate 43 Benadryls, your dad was like, as soon as your dad, you know, an upright middle class, and he has military background, right?
Yep, Air Force.
Right.
Air Force.
So as soon as your dad, who's this, you know, the opposite, sees weed, I guess 43 Benadryl, it's like, you fucking kid. But I'll tell you something, and this is fucked up, Jed, and I just need to say this. I've been taking Benadryl, like, a lot. Like, I've been taking Benadryl, like, for months or something. And I take, like, a pill. I take half a pill at night to go to bed. I'm sneezing. And I take it. I take it to sleep deeply. I know that I take it because I love the dreams on Benadryl.
Yep.
And last night I didn't take it. And I kind of woke up in the middle of the night and I was, like, scared. You know what I mean? Like that I was addicted to Benadryl, but then I went back to bed and I wasn't addicted to Benadryl, and I tell my sponsor about it, but even just hearing Benadryl fucking hallucinations, but then it's 43 Benadryls, but still somebody also wrote me an email about Benadryl. And like, that I shouldn't be sober. I shouldn't say I'm sober because I'm taking Benadryl.
Oh, that's crazy. And well, dude, I still take. All right. It's not crazy. Yes. But remember, there's like a difference between dependent and addicted. And in your case, you're talking about like a physical dependence on sleep, right? Because I recently got off of my nighttime antidepressant medication. And since then, I pretty much have to take like a Unisom or something to sleep. And I do wish I didn't have to. But like the alternative is so awful. Like as soon as I hit the pillow, the mind is going 1,000 miles an hour, and so it's like, whatever. It's the less. Like, do I wish it was different? Yes. Is it the lesser of 1,000 evils right now? Sure. But I think you're aware of it. I think that's the important thing.
No, I agree, but I also like, I don't know. Like, I've been waking up really early, and with Benadryl, and I wake up early, I feel like shit. This morning I woke up really early and I felt pretty good. So like, I think I want to, but I really, I mean, I think that the issue is that I like the dreams. Like that's an issue. Like that's something.
In that case, there's like different things you can do for that. Just like eat a huge carbo load before you go to bed. You'll have crazy dreams. Melatonin, really? Crazy dreams. Oh yeah.
You'll just get crazy fat. Melatonin, I feel like I wake up after I take melatonin and I feel like shit too. But let's get back to the story. I don't want to divert. It's my own fault. I just wanted to. I feel like when like I do this show, right, and I talk about recovery or whatever, and I'm taking Benadryl, and people are writing me like, you're not sober, and you tell a story about getting busted on 43 Benadryl, I have to disclose that I've been taking it.
Yeah.
Whatever. You know what I mean? I mean. So
real quick on that, have you ever heard of Jimson weed or Angel Trumpets or Datura? Have you ever heard of those?
Yeah.
Okay.
I've heard of them. Right.
Those are in the same family of diphenhydramine. They're classified as deliriant. Same as like scopolamine. You ever heard that? The devil's breath, where they like you blow it into someone's face and they become your mind control zombie. You ever seen that?
No, tell me about that.
That it's overblown. It's a lot of people think it's kind of, but like it was in that movie, The Green Inferno, which was a remake of Cannibal Holocaust. But in like third world countries, it's like this voodoo witchcraft thing where like you take this plant matter, scopolamine, and you grind it up into a powder and you blow it into someone's face and they become your zombie, essentially.
What's the reality behind scopolamine?
It's just a potent deliriant. And it's also marketed as, the travel sickness Dramamine. Not Dramamine. It's another one. Dramamine is, that's another. We would also take that to get fucked up, but there's another motion sickness medicine that has scopolamine in it that everyone takes. It's funny how people.
But
take
the actual
these,
voodoo,
like,
the voodoo mind control is far fetched, right? I can't blow some scopolamine at Howie, and all of a sudden he's competent, right?
Probably not, but who knows? Maybe there's, you know, who knows? I don't want to find out, but yeah, we can get back to it. This is also why. This is why Chris was my kindred spirit, because I just spend hours researching and finding out about drugs and reading trip reports, and like Chris was my kindred spirit in that regard.
Yeah, he was fucking gifted with that shit, right? He like, yep. And I always was doing this, trying to backpedal and remember and be like, explain this and explain that, and he was incredibly invested in it, as are you. So you get sent away after 40, or you get sent to outpatient, and then what happens? I like this behind outpatient. Jed, behind the dope Jed. This is the real deal. Here we go.
So outpatient was a joke. It was just
Louisiana.
Me, which is, no, this is in South Carolina.
Okay,
this is in South Carolina. It was just me and all my friends, essentially, that we were getting screwed up together in the first place. So it was just kind of a big joke. I started going to NA meetings then, which honestly, like, it can be so dangerous to send someone into that kind of world. It's like, you know, the old thing, you go in with a associate's degree in weed and you come out with a master's degree in heroin. You know, chopping dope. Yeah.
Right, right. Or it's just like, it's like sending, it's like untreated addiction plus your kids. Like, it's like sex, it's like sex, drugs, and rock and roll, zero recovery. It's like the zero opposite recovery of what it's supposed to be. Yeah.
Yeah.
It sounds
and
exciting.
It was fun. And yeah. Yeah, and like as a high schooler, it kind of gives you like this bad boy, like, oh, well, like, you know, it's like baby jail kind of.
Right.
And, oh, God. Oh, yeah. So my first introduction to NA was a joke because like my sponsor ended up asking me to find him weed. So I was just like, okay, so this whole thing is no one's really sober. It's all a joke.
It's all bullshit, right?
So things just got bad again. And got bad enough that I had to go to inpatient treatment. So I was on a waiting list.
What were you doing to get to that? They decided you have to go to inpatient.
I ran away for 3 days, and that was the straw that broke the camel's back. Just because I
was
tired of like
having. What did
you do
when you ran away? Where'd you go? Who'd you go with?
I just took a bunch. I went to this kid Anthony's house and just did a bunch of ecstasy because I was tired of. I was tired of having to, like, sneak out and, like, hide my drug use. And I was just like, fuck this. I'm just gonna go get high without worrying about, like, my parents finding out. But all I did was just not answer my phone. And none of my friends knew where I was. So in retrospect, my poor parents just thought I was fucking dead. Like, I should have just answered and said, hey, I'm just getting high. So when I got home, the cops were there and it was a whole big thing. And they're like, you need to go somewhere. And I was like, okay. Oh, and like I was, cocaine was the first thing that I did that I got truly addicted to. And I started selling and stealing things. I just stole things out of my own home and sold them.
How old were you when you were doing that?
15, 16.
Yeah, you were fucking hardcore, super early. Like ridiculously hardcore,
yeah.
Super. How much coke were you selling at 15, 16?
No, selling items to get coke.
Right. Okay.
Yeah. Like selling to support my habit.
Were you shooting it then or no?
No. Well, I say no, but it would be a year later, but
right. No, I would never until I was 17.
But that was also, I started making counterfeit money to support my habit when I was 16. And that was back before, when they had the old $20 bills. Some of y'all might not remember that, but they were just, we got an inkjet printer and I figured out I could just make them on my printer and they actually looked really good. And then I would like put my fake ones in a dryer with a bunch of real ones and some coins and just run them in the dryer and they'd feel real. And I worked at a pizza restaurant, and so I was working the cashier. So I would every now and then I would slip a fake one in and take out two real tens. But I got super sloppy, and they started getting just faker and faker. And one day my manager found one, and he goes, wait a minute. And he goes into the safe, and I just see him start to pull out all my fake 20s. And that's when I found out if there's fake money involved, they call the Secret Service. And the Secret Service showed up at my job during the shift that I was working, so I was terrified. And my dad later told me I didn't get caught. There's no way they could prove it was me.
Did they know it was you?
No.
Okay. That's crazy.
But my dad, when I got honest, like during family day or something, my dad told me, he was like, you know, I found a bunch of, like, my trial and error money, I just threw it in our trash can. He's like, I found that stuff in the trash, but I thought there's no way he is that stupid. I thought you were just playing. And I was like, yeah, it turns out I'm that dumb, Dad. That's what I was doing.
But no one ever caught you with the counterfeit.
No.
They didn't catch you at work. Nobody caught you. Did you use it to buy drugs or did you use all of the counterfeit money at work?
At work. It was like in total, it was only a couple $100.
That could like, have been it was a very... if they hadn't come
oh,
in,
yeah,
that could
bro.
Have been like a scam that ruined your whole life. You know, 100%. Like, that's a crazy one because they go crazy for that shit. When the Secret Service came in, were you just like, I'm not doing this?
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. I was like, that's the end of that. And I was standing by the back door. I was like, I'm just going to make a run for it if they call my name in there.
You became such a fucking drug addict. I would always have it in my back pocket. If I ever made money that passed as money, like, I remember when I was in L.A., like my friend Todd wound up with a couple 50s, like, that were fake. Like, he was working on a movie set, and he got a couple of fake 50s. And I was like, dude, those look kind of real. And I was like, give them to me. And we went down and we copped dope with them in downtown Los Angeles. But if I had a way of making them, I would have fucking been making them. I'm surprised you never went back to the well on that one.
Well, so the last thing I did before I got sober was my buddy called me and he said, hey, I just got $2,000 in fake hundreds. And I looked at them and they looked great. And I was like, oh, I know what I'm doing. So the last night in town, I went to every one of my dope dealers and ripped them off with fake money and then just skipped town, went to rehab. That was the last thing I did.
It ever come back on you?
Oh, yeah. But it came back on one part. Like, actually, pretty much three of them sent me the, like, I'm going to find you and I'm going to kill you text. And I was like, okay, sure you are. Like, no, you're not. And one of them got arrested like a week later. So no, it never came back on me.
Okay, so
fuck
you're
them,
in,
dude.
You're all right. Good for. I'd be still scared. I'd be like looking out the windows now, fucking 25
fuck
years later.
Them.
What was I going to
say?
So
yes. So I had this list because back then I was just super enamored and obsessed with the idea of like the romantic drug addict. I loved like Burroughs and Bukowski and Fear and Loathing in Las Vegas. So I had this journal. I had a list of all the drugs I had tried and heroin I had never tried. And so I'm on this waiting list to go to treatment and it was 4 months long. And I was like, well, I'm already going to treatment. Let me try to do every drug that I can before I have to quit forever. This is what I was thinking. And I'd never tried heroin, and I found someone that could get me heroin. I was just planning on snorting it, though. And I went to their house. This is when I was 17. I went to their house. They got the heroin. They came back, and they're like, you're going to snort it? And I was like, yeah. They're like, dude, just shoot it. And I was like, really? You think so? And they're like, yeah. And I was like, well, I can't do it. And I was terrified of needles, like terrified.
Sure.
And they're like, we'll do it for you. And I was like, okay. So I just like turned my head and reached my
have
arm out
it.
And
yeah.
Have at it. Yeah. How crazy. Like that was my line in the sand. And all it took for him was basically to be like, come on. And I was
like,
okay.
It's like, you shouldn't snort it. And you're like, okay.
So by the time
when that happens and you're 17 and you're like a Burroughs fan, in the back of your head, are you like, as soon as he says it, it's like, well, I can be like my hero. I can be like the real thing. I can skip this bullshit and I'll actually be hardcore or whatever.
Yes. So, to the point where it's so cringy to admit, but I would like proud, like I was hoping people at school would notice my track marks so that they would be like, hey, what are those? And I'd be like, nothing. Don't worry about it. How fucking insane is that though? But that's really what screwed me was because for the longest time I thought that I made myself a drug addict. Like I thought I was playing because and really it turned out like I was a like diagnosed borderline personality disorder teenager just looking for attention, and I thought that was the way to get it. So I would I relished when I guess it was like kind of the plight of the suburban white kid who never had anything wrong in his life. So I like created my own pain. Well, so now
it did,
I had
it did
a reason.
Number of things, though. It did a number of things. It created this interesting personality, but that also like diminishes like how good it feels to get high. Or it also diminishes like how much you loved music and art that were around this same topic. So yeah, you're like, you have your problem, but your problem also came with medication, and it came with dopamine, and it came with hallucinating, and it came with feeling like, I mean, I always felt like when I started using that, I needed to burn off my privilege. And it's like, it doesn't make sense. And it's cringy in the same way. Like, I just felt like I had it. Like, I needed to experience something else, like, because I didn't think I was enough. You know what I mean? Like, deep down.
Yeah.
I didn't think I had enough going on that I needed. And I was medicating, too. You know, it was more than one thing. But it becomes, like, after you go through the whole thing, you feel pretty sad. And then, I mean, and then you can also feel shame there. There's so many opportunities to find shame. You know what I mean?
It's like, it was all a perfect storm, right? Because also it's like when I was 11, I got diagnosed with Tourette's syndrome because I used to blink my eyes and I would scrunch my nose
like ticks.
Ticks, really, really, really bad ticks, and I got made fun of it, and it was a whole fucking thing. And drugs were really the first thing that like calmed it down.
Yeah.
And I had depression. I'd been suicidal since 10 or 11. That's just like how my depression manifests itself is suicidal ideation. So like I legitimately had depression, and then I'm putting myself through these crazy highs and lows. I had a lot of like sexual shame due to like my religious upbringing, and drugs were the only thing that kept that in check. So it was a very perfect storm for me to just become an absolute drug addict.
Yeah, it was a winter mix.
And so they also introduced me to shooting up cocaine, which was, you know, that's a monster right there. So by the time I got to that treatment center, I really needed to go there. The first one, though, was a fundamentalist Christian faith-based treatment center in the mountains where, like, they did an exorcism on me and, like, all sorts of... Yeah.
So how scary is that?
So the way they did it, it was called deliverance class, and what they did was they put 20 of you in a classroom. There was three priests walking around, and they give you this CD player, or a tape player, with a recording of the grandfather of the guy that opened the place, and it was a recording of him screaming at you in tongues. So just gibberish screaming at you. And
what does that sound like?
Like shamalamala shakada shaha shawhang and shamalamala toyaraka, like just like screaming and aggressive. And when you feel something,
was that scary or was that like these guys are full of shit? Or was it powerful? Like, how did you interpret it at that age?
I went into it thinking it was legit and like looking forward to it, and like I guess because I was really, you know, I was looking for anyone that said this is why you're doing what you're doing. I was like, oh, that'd be great because that means there's a solution.
Also, though, because you were taken with science fiction, you were taken with metal,
fantasy,
you were taken with paranoia, fantasy. A demon inside of you was probably a really exciting prospect.
Sure. Yeah. And
keep going. So what happens?
So when you feel something, and ironically, when you're like, so what are the signs? It can be yawning, sneezing,
right.
Anxiety. There's a very long list of signs. So I thought I felt something, so I raised my hand. They all swarm on you. You take the headphones off. They all lay their hands on you. They ask the demon its name first, and then once it's named, then they try to call it out of you.
How do they know its name? How do they find out its name?
They scream at you. No, it was more like a demon of lust, demon of cigarettes, demon of heroin, something like that.
Right.
And I will say the only thing that I noticed was when the guy touched me, his hand felt red hot. And I did not want him to touch me. Like, it was super uncomfortable.
Do you think he was wearing the electric glove?
Who knows, bro? Who knows?
Wow.
And you know,
Surtur. Did he come up with any like
Beelzebub?
Yeah, Beelzebub, Beetlejuice, begun. My God.
So, I go through it, and then when you're done, you go outside, and we're sitting in the smoke area, and I ask another guy, I was like, so I saw you raise your hand. Did you feel something? And he was like, fuck no, I just wanted to go smoke a cigarette. And I was like, okay.
Wow.
So I get out of there, and of course, just immediately go back to it, and this is when really, the addiction started, because now I'm shooting coke and heroin, and I end up just running away from home.
I have a question. When you go into this treatment, does any part of you think the way they deal with this is at all helpful, or is there anything that they're doing right? And the exorcism, what's your takeaway from this? You know, with retrospect.
I thought I was cured. Because for all whatever they did there, I will say I felt incredibly close to God. And it was a place full of decades-long hardened ex-cons. And I saw those men, shatter like glass and break down in tears. And, I mean, I stayed there for 3 months, and I literally thought I was good to go, which was kind of the problem, because they didn't AA or anything was not in your aftercare plan. It was basically just go to church and you're good to go. They just kind of taught that you can be healed from it once and for all, and so I thought that for sure. And I remember I got home. And I was doing day school because I had missed too much classes. And I was just hanging around my house one day. I went in the refrigerator. I saw there was some whipped cream, and I sucked the nitrous out of it. And as soon as I did that, it was just like, oh no, I've, sinned again. Yeah, it's over. Here comes the guilt. Here comes the shame. And that was it.
What was the thing you did after you took the hit off the whipped cream?
Ecstasy.
Just, and you were like,
ecstasy.
You call your friend, I just hit the whipped cream. You
No. I called my friend and I said, my sister wants some ecstasy, because my friends knew I just came back from treatment. So I had to play that game for a second. And I
do you
just
think
it
was the same? Was it the same day you hit the whipped cream, or was it a few
days?
No,
it was like a week later. It was like a week later. Yeah, it wasn't the same day. And then shortly after that.
Right. What were you doing for ecstasy, coke, heroin? Was it just like that?
Then it was almost exclusively cocaine and heroin. And then I really got into shooting cocaine. And then I one night, because my dude didn't answer, I taught myself how to shoot up just by trial and error with cocaine. And my arms looked like slushy balloons, just full of misses. That's also when I remember I ended up when you open a new deodorant, you know how it's really sharp?
Yeah.
So I had wicked it against a trash can, and so it created all these shavings. And so I'm carpet crawling one night, and I find this pile of white. And I was like, no way. And I put it to my tongue, and I lick it, and it's bitter. And I'm like, oh, my God. And I put it in a spoon, and it breaks down in water. And I'm like, oh, my God. And I hit it, and I'm like, ugh.
So you shot up deodorant.
Wow. I shot up deodorant. Yeah.
Wow. That's a fucking. And what? And did you you taste the wintry?
You tasted like, the yeah. zinc.
Yeah.
It was off. Oh. Yeah.
But your breath probably smelled really fresh.
Yeah, absolutely. Just shooting up pure aluminum.
How bad did it go from there?
Oh, it just got... I found out that I had gotten hepatitis C from the first needle I used. And I was like, oh, well, you know, I'm planning on dying by 23 anyway. I just gave up. I found an older girl who had a place down in Charleston. I ran away from home, and I moved in with her for the summer, and was just shooting heroin and cocaine, and just it just got super awful. And my parents had found this treatment center in Louisiana, and they were trying to ambush me. Like, they kept trying to tell me we're going on family vacation, and I was like, no, we're not. I know this trick. And one night, I guess it's that moment of clarity they talk about, but I was just so miserable, and I just called my mom, and I was like, come get me. And so then I just hopped on a plane. This is when I was 17, still, and I hopped on a plane, and that's when I left home, and I never went back, except for a few short months. But that's when I moved to Louisiana to go to treatment, and it was a year-long treatment center.
Wow.
The best treatment center I've ever been to in my life, because that was in 2005, and four of the people I was in there with are my best friends to this day, which is insane to think about. Very rare. I mean, he was my best man, and that's Dirty Mike, if people have listened to Church and Other Drugs. He was a regular on there. He was my best man at my wedding. He stayed sober the whole time. The rest of us have just gone in and out, and we pull each other back into sobriety. We pulled each other out of sobriety. It's just a crazy relationship. But then, I mean, that was really just the beginning of, I mean, I went to 19 treatment centers in total from the time I was 15 until I was 27.
Right.
And I mean, things just got.
What was the longest you were on heroin for? Was there like a long stretch, and how did you support it?
Two years. So finally, I guess when I was like 22, so I beat, cocaine was an addiction. I beat years before I got sober. Like, I finally decided, like, even if I want to keep using, I cannot do cocaine anymore.
Why?
Because once I start shooting coke and crack, it's over, dude. Like, I just ruin my life. Like, I ended up being like a live-in servant for this woman coke dealer. I was basically like her slave, like her pet. Like, I would like go grocery shop. It was just the weirdest situations I found myself in. I would steal
from
everyone.
I want to hear about that situation. Who's the woman? Where do you live? What are you doing for? Is there sex involved? What's the deal?
There was no sex involved, because she was 25 years older than me. She was just this cocaine dealer, and I would basically just like live in her house. She had this puppy that would shit all over the floor. I cleaned up from the puppy, and then every now and then her big giant boyfriend drug dealer would come over, and she would shove me in the closet and tell me to be quiet, because I guess if he found me there, he would kill me, because I guess the implication would be that I'm having sex with her, even though we weren't. I would do her laundry, run her errands, take care of her, like, because she was an alcoholic.
How much coke would she give you? Was it unlimited coke, or it was like a decent
basically
deal? Like, right,
basically, yeah.
You got to use and, with her if you were if you did the domestic stuff. You got to use with her.
Yeah, and it actually was super sad, because she had an estranged son my age, And so it was really just this fucked up, like, surrogacy thing. Because yeah. I remember I had gotten out of there, and one night I was just out of everything. This is when also, God, there's so much insanity. Like, I went on a run where I did a bunch of acid while I was shooting coke, so all my cocaine delusions were real. You know what I'm saying? And I know I'm having to go to treatment soon, but I just called her crying, and I'm like, I just need one more before I, please, I just need a gram before I go. And she meets up with me, and then she like breaks down crying because she's like, your mom must be so worried, and like, here you go, like, don't die. It's just, it's like really bizarre.
I don't relation. Know. I think, like, I feel like things like that, like, are some of the most interesting things around addiction that people don't talk a lot about, these weird relationships with fellow users or dealers. Or like, I used to get high with this couple, old couple, I guess it was in Soho, and they were like in their 60s, and I would hang out with them every day. And like, they wouldn't give me dope, but we'd all cop together every morning. And the craziest thing with that was, like, it's similar in this, that they had a son who was a couple years older than me, but it turned out I knew him, and he went to my high school. It was insane. It was fucking insane. It was insane. But I feel like this is a topic that doesn't get talked about a lot. Like, how many people, I mean, like, everybody has like a crew of people they used with that they never would have known. But something like that, where it's like, were you living there? Where'd you sleep?
I didn't sleep.
Okay. Right. And the boyfriend, like, I mean, never when met I did, you?
There were a few very close calls where, like, he came unannounced, and I literally had to, like one time she forgot about me in the closet, and I woke up, I guess I ended up passing out, and I woke up, like, a full day later just in this closet, just dying of thirst, and I didn't know, and I'm cocaine paranoid, so it's just like, and we're talking like, you know, a gangster, like, right. A real deal. Like, I'll fucking kill you, white boy, type of thing.
Right, right. That's interesting. So also, like, let me ask you this. Post-first exorcism, were you ever in those years, those early years, were you ever like, there's a demon in me? Was that ever a thought?
Yes. Yeah, because there's this Bible verse that says, if you come and bind the strong man in the house, and then the strong man gets out, he's going to come back with seven of his friends and take up occupation in the house. And basically that verse is saying, you get rid of one demon, but then you go back to your ways, seven more come and take their place. And so in my mind, it was like, oh, now I'm in a real situation, because it's not just one, it's many. And I mean, honestly, dude, especially like when I started getting into meth and stuff, I don't even know that that's far from the truth. There's a lot of parallels in like serious psychedelic, and I got into research chemicals and meth. There's like, meth for some reason has an odd, dark, spiritual attachment to it. And I'm really not even ready to say that that's not
a demon,
a possibility. Yeah.
Well, even addiction, addiction as demonology is a fair idea. Like, it is. I mean, like, everyone's like, oh, he has his demons. It's like, when you're actually addicted to heroin or shooting coke or shooting meth, it's there. I want to hear more about this idea with meth, though. Like, what exactly are you saying? Because I did meth for a very short period of time. And I didn't, I mean, like, I basically did meth as a transition to get back into heroin. I never got attached to anything that wasn't weed, pills, heroin, psychedelics. But I did meth, and I chuck coke, and I did that shit. But it was nothing. It didn't stick around. But I want to hear, I think this is an interesting idea around meth addiction and demonology. Like,
so this was when, like, the 2Cs, like 2CI, 2CT, 2CB, 4MEO, DMT, all the research chemicals were the hot commodity. And so I'm doing a lot of those, and then I'm also doing a lot of meth. And my apartment at the time, I would have, like, there were scrawlings all over the wall. I would have, I don't know if I would call it hearing voices, but doing things, saying things that I had a couple rage episodes where like my voice changed. There was one time when I was in a room with a bunch of people doing meth and I kind of looked up and everyone in the room looked like they had shark eyes, like just these black soulless eyes. And so my last night, what really scared me into getting sober, my last night using, we were in this basement and it was three of us smoking meth, each of us in a corner and
alone.
No
like
one was
separated. Right.
Yes. No one was talking. All you could hear was like the crinkle of a bag, flicking lighters, foil, mixing in a spoon. Right. And so I looked up and I looked at my friend. This was a dude I met. That was the other thing I did was I would meet people in rehab. We would leave and then I would get their connections and we'd just use together, which is just a nightmare every time. But this guy, I looked up and it was like, you know, those videos of like you'll be watching it and something will jump out at you and it's like a jump scare video. So I looked up at this guy and this like long-legged dog faced, kind of like almost like a werewolf looking thing jumped out of him at me, like hands around the throat, and I shook and I realized that I guess I kind of like nodded because I jumped out of my chair to the point where they both looked up and they're like, whoa, what the fuck? And it was so viscerally real to me that I got up, I went to my car and I fucking drove to rehab.
Like, so were you like it can be meth psychosis, it can be a hallucination, or it can be a demon. And I guess all of those things can be the same thing in a moment like that.
Yeah.
And then,
what I took it as was a sign. So our plan, this was the dude that gave me the counterfeit money also. And so we still had some left. And our plan was in the morning, we were going to go to this girl that worked at a restaurant and we were going to switch out more money for actual real money. So we had like this whole plan involved and I took it as like, this is like whatever these people are doing, it's going to end badly and you need to get away. Because I started, and I tell people this all the time, like I tell people like, you know, I've relapsed and gotten sober and gotten in trouble enough times to know that, and I still feel like God looks out for me even when I'm out there, is that you're going to get street signs and it's on you whether you're going to read them or not. And so that was an instance where I said, like, I need to read the signs.
And then, so what did you do?
Hold on one sec. I drove to a gas station because I didn't have enough gas. So the treatment center was in Lafayette. I didn't have enough gas to get there. I drove to a gas station, hung around. It was so rare. This is like, you know, the random gas station. This one of my old using buddies pulled up and he was like, da 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 da. Turned out he had some Suboxone. He gave me a Suboxone, which was a godsend. I called another old using friend who had gotten sober.
Were you sick or did you get high off of it?
I was still high. Yeah. That was also what kind of did it for me was that night I shot 2 grams of heroin and just did not feel a thing. And I mean, it was good heroin, but I was just like, okay, we're at the end of the rope. There's no more feel good neurons to go around. Like this is it.
You know, there's no maintaining that shit.
There's no, it's the end. And
so he gives, you don't take the Suboxone.
And my girlfriend,
what happened with that Suboxone? You didn't take it.
I took it. Yeah. Fuck. Yeah.
But you didn't go into precipitated withdrawal off of it.
No, no. Maybe I didn't. Maybe that was a different time. Yeah. 'Cause that doesn't make sense. Maybe I pocketed it. I don't know.
Doesn't matter.
His name was Robin. Maybe it doesn't matter. But I don't want to get any emails debating the veracity of my stories. Let's just say I was high. I don't remember. So I get someone to give me some gas money. Nobody trusts me, so it took a while. Like, sure, you're going to rehab, buddy. Again. But I found someone to give me gas money. I don't even remember driving to Lafayette, but the next thing I remember, I'm in Lafayette, and one of my buddies from the rehab I went to, who I'm still friends with today, met me and took me to rehab.
And that was and it was a different experience.
It was a different experience.
You put yourself because I was enough. What, please?
That was the first and only time I, because my no one at this point, parent, nobody is talking to me. I had also the last part, my best friend who had put his house up to bail me out of jail one time, I had ripped him off. I had just done things that I had never done before. And this was the only time I took it to the end. And this was the only time I had, during this relapse, I had started snorting heroin and I was like, I'm not going to shoot up. You're not going to do it. And 2 weeks later I was shooting up, and it surprised me. I was like, wow. And that may seem silly to some people, but for the first time I was like, oh, I can't control this. Like, This is bad.
This is like addiction.
Yeah, this is addiction. And nothing was fun anymore. I'm 27. I'm still on probation for a 10-year deferred sentence. There's a title loan out on the car that I'm driving.
What was the 10-year deferred sentence?
It would be too long to
just tell me
go in the time.
Just tell me.
That was when I finally got arrested for the stealing a car from a casino, and I had a bunch of drugs, and my house got raided, and a whole thing.
Serious fucking business. So you finally get to treatment, 27, and you're like, I'm ready.
Yeah. Well, and it really took... I thought I was ready, and I was 60 days clean. They had just given me my driver's license to go get a job, and the girlfriend I had at the time called me while I was in there and broke up with me, and I went outside and I punched the wall and I broke my hand, and in that split second I said, I'm going to fuck this. I'm leaving. I'm going to go to the ER and get some pain pills. And I had another moment of clarity that said, oh, wait a minute. That's all it took for you to go do this whole thing again. And instead of doing that, I went and told the people what I was thinking about doing. And I think that was really, I went in my room and had like a long tearful conversation with God, and I think that was the time I actually surrendered and was like, I need help, or I'm gonna do this again. So that was really, it still took, because for the first 60 days it was business as usual. Like, I always do good in treatment. I always do good at first. And I just did everything different when I got out. Actually, like, went to a sober living. I joined a men's big book study. I sponsored people, took meetings to treatment centers. I worked a minimum wage job at a coffee shop for 9 months. I mean, I just did every possible thing I could. I mean, my parents still didn't talk to me until I was a year sober. And when they picked me up from the airport, they still didn't believe I was sober. Like, that's how little my word meant.
It's very similar to Chris's story, because that all happened to him. His dad didn't talk to him for a year, I think. And you fell in with 12 step though. You decided that it worked, and you became, and that was like, I mean, I'm sure that also played a part from your religious upbringing, and it's all tied together in this amazing way. And your life changed. Do you not have time to go to the current thing? You're out of time.
No.
You're at work?
Yeah, well, I got another podcast to do, actually, for someone else.
What's the
else.
Next podcast?
It's for this podcast called Pastor with No Answers.
All right. Well,
yeah.
Listen, I think
we should do a part two, though.
Yeah, I'm down. I think this was an amazing Behind the Dope. Amazing. Like,
thank you.
I realize
you've never heard that. And still there was, you know, a good decade of skip stuff so we can do a part two.
Well, thank you, Chad. What do you think? What do you think about going all over all that stuff? Is it all old hat or is it
No, it's good. It's good to remember, especially it's really good to remember because that was you say that about the Chris parallel. That's also what kicked me back in gear because me and Chris also bonded over talking shit about AA. It was me, my buddy Besh, and Chris. So because we were all studying to be counselors and therapists and psychiatrists, and we had gotten this thing where we're like, yeah, AA is not the only way, and we had all collectively slacked, and then Chris died, and that was like, oh, wait, fuck, that's what happens, you know?
Like, and just to think about it, I remember me and him having conversations where he was like, he was talking about old relapses, and he would be like, well, in this old relapse, I would stop going to meetings. I would start hanging out with my girlfriend and I would be doing this and that. And I'd be like, well, what are you doing now? And he'd start giggling. He'd be like, oh yeah, I stopped going to meetings and I'm hanging out with my new girlfriend. And it's like, dude. And like the idea of death was never on the table. Right.
No,
I know. It's like crazy, crazy.
So it really, I guess I don't hate to say, but it shocked me back into, because that's the shitty part about, especially, and because I also related to the fact that we are in that 1% of the 10% of drug, like a lot of people in AA and recovery, they can skate by doing the bare minimum because factually they just weren't as bad. And I know it's not a comparison game, but in my experience counseling thousands of addicts, there is such a thing
comparison.
As like worse. Yes,
right,
there are
right.
worse cases. And I considered that I was one of those that could dilly-dally, but no, I mean, I can't, unfortunately. And with longer-term sobriety, the temptation and tendency to slack off is so real.
Sure.
And I mean, and it's just because like I love chemicals. I loved drugs and I still have a fascination with them. And that was Chris's thing too. Like perusing like the opiate subreddit and stuff.
Yeah.
It's like, there's still that fascination and I have to be real careful with that.
No, I remember like in the very early days of Dopey, like we were like, maybe he was like, I don't know if it was his idea or my idea, but one of us was like, you should hit your neck with this syringe full of water opiate subreddit. And then he was like, no, I can't do it. But dude, let's definitely do a part two. Thank you for coming through and dropping the fucking serious Dopey. I'm very
sure.
angry at myself for not doing this earlier, but who cares? Here we are. And, life goes on, but
life goes on, man.
All right. Well, I love you, Jed. I'm happy to see you on the video. That we this is cool, right?
It is cool. I'm digging it. And if you like what you hear, check me out on Church and Other Drugs, wherever you listen to podcasts.
Wherever you listen to podcasts, check out Jed on Church and Other Drugs. And we'll definitely do a part two and fucking stay
awesome.
Strong, Dopey Nation, and fucking
stay strong, Dopey Nation. Vape Knox.
Vape Knox for Chris. Thanks, Jed.
Love you, bro.
Love you too. So that was Jed.
Shout out to Jed.
Fucking from the pantheon of Dopey history to the Dopey present.
Great word.
And we will have Jed come back for part two. I mean, the whole plan was to do this whole thing about what he's up to now. And then I was like, holy shit, we never got that fire dopey out of him before.
You got some fire dopey out of him this time.
What were your favorite moments?
When he was talking about a priest speaking to him in tongues, bro.
Speaking tongues.
Not only that, what's his name? And you go, Steve.
Steve, bring out
the demon out of me, Steve.
Steve, bring it out of me.
What'd you call him? Beelzebub?
Beelzebub? I don't know. But Jed, thank you. We love having Jed on the show.
Jed, fucking crazy, Jed. That's fucking crazy. And then he's a live-in servant. That's fucking crazy.
The live-in servant part was classic.
Fucking crazy.
That's classic.
Go hide in the closet. Forgot about the guy for like a day.
That's when you know you're in trouble. When you're in the closet.
Trapped in the closet. Shout out to R. Kelly.
Well, there we go. I feel really, I feel good. I feel like this has been some fire dopey session.
Fiery.
And if we want the one person that could ruin the fire to the dopey session, that would probably be my dad. And my dad has a lot to say, so we're going to get him on the show. My dad has a lot to say to Jay, I think.
Oh, really?
And I want to hear how my father, what he delivers.
Oh, that's going to be great.
All right, here we go.
Hello.
Hey, Dad, welcome back to the show.
Oh, I'm on the show. Hi. Hello, everybody.
You're not only... the connection is weird for some reason.
Oh, come on. It's got to be good. I've been using the phone for 2 days. Everybody's saying it's fine.
It sounds bad. Better. Hold on. I hear my... Hold on for 1 sec. Okay, listen, Dad. You're on the phone with Fentanyl, a.k.a. Phenomenal J. Do you have anything you want to say to him?
Mr. Mannheim.
Oh, hello. Hi, Jay.
What's up?
I'm
doing well. How are you?
No, I'm not so great. You know, my brother is trying to call me now, but I don't even know how to handle it. But anyway, no, I'm not so great. My shoulder hurts. My knee hurts. But what the heck? I guess I'm old. But I got to get better because I need to be able to walk and play golf and enjoy myself.
Play golf.
Listen, hold on, Dad. I didn't have you on the phone to talk about what ails you. I wanted you to come down on Fentanyl J.
Oh, well, hold on. He asked me how I was.
That's
so
right. Just you'll
milk any opportunity to complain, I know.
Yeah, where do you get it from, Dave?
Jay, you tell me, how are you? How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. I'm better than ever, actually. You know? Just got back from the gym. Nothing to complain about except my whole entire life. But other than that.
Oh, okay. Any word about this business with prison thing?
Oh, it's coming down the pipeline. Looking forward to it. No, I don't know. It's all in limbo. I'm in limbo right now.
So you have no idea what's going to happen then?
No idea.
Dad, tell Jay what you said to me when you listened to Jay talk about his friend Ian with the gun in the canal.
Listen, Jay, I guess you know this already, but you've done some pretty, you know, quote, I'm going to use the word all bad stuff in the past. You've done some bad stuff. So when you heard you give your gun, I said, oh, good grief. I mean, the only good thing that happened with that is that he threw it away. That was the only good thing.
Am I being reprimanded by your dad right now?
Keep going, Dad. Say, keep going, Dad.
Well, I mean, reprimanded. You know what you did. I mean, this is for you to turn over and then a new leaf and live your, what do you guys say? Live your best life.
Live the best life. True.
Do the next right thing.
Do the next right thing.
Now, Dad, I should have had you ready for this. There's been some new... anything else you want to... Jay, what do you want to say to my dad? Does he sound like a sensible Jewish man?
He sounds exactly like I thought he would sound.
Yes. Dad, there's been some good reviews, and I figured you might want to take some pleasure in reading the new good dopey reviews.
Well, how could I... What do you mean? I have to get on the computer or something?
No, I'm going to send it to your mind right now. Stand by. Yes, you have to read it off the computer.
Oh, hold on. So where would it be? Like on the iTunes thing?
You look at the iTunes review every day.
I know. I didn't see anything today.
Not from today, but last week there's some good ones.
Oh, yeah. I did read those. Yeah. No, they were very good. Yeah, they were. So
iTunes.
You want the Dopey Nation to hear this? Is that it?
No, I know you like reading reviews. I figured you'd like to reprimand Jay about the gun in the canal.
True.
And infamous Ian.
True.
And I figured you haven't read a review on the show in a while. And I wanted to give you more of a complaining platform.
Well-deserved reprimandation? Is that a word?
Reprimandation. Is reprimandation a word? Reprimandment?
Well, reprimanding is the word. Yes. All right, wait a minute. Here it comes. So, okay.
He sounds just like a Bollywood.
He's a wonderful man. He's a good guy.
Shout out to Mr. Mannheim.
But we have to stop saying, just call him Alan, because we have to bleep the last name.
Oh, really?
Because he's worried that people are going to track him down.
True.
Dad, didn't somebody track you down at school? He teaches at FIT in Manhattan.
Oh, really?
Making it much easier. Good group.
Shout out to Alan.
At this point, it doesn't matter. You don't have to bleep anything. Whatever happens, happens. All right. So you want me to read Jessica Menschinski's thing, my friends?
No. Yeah, well, you could. That was a girl me and Chris went to detox with. But I wanted you to read the one before that first.
CC Stat?
I think so. Was that a good one?
Yes, 5 stars. All right, so this is by a CC Stat, and it says love with 5 stars.
Nice.
Okay, it says, I was listening to last day as I have had a husband who overdosed, oh boy, and committed suicide. Now, years later, my oldest son is addicted to meth and heroin. On last day, Dave was a guest. I now listen to Dopey and find myself laughing in the car on my way to work. Rush hour. Other people going slow beside me, taking a double take when they see me laughing to myself. By myself, no one in the car. You are the best. Wow. Yeah, that's a good review, but a sad story.
What about before that one?
Best podcast ever.
That sounds like a good one.
Solid.
Yeah, by TMM1102. I love this podcast. I listen to this every day.
By the way, Dad, wait. Before you say another word, I just have to warn you. And I want to apologize to the Dopey Nation at how bad my dad's phone sounds. And Dad, when you hear this episode, you're going to be like, oh, David, I can't believe how bad my phone sounds. You were right this whole time because it sounds terrible. Just so we're clear, Dad.
All right, so I'll complain about your sound quality.
I'm telling you, you tell him it sounds bad, then it sounds good. Then he puts his thumb over the microphone, doesn't know what's going on, and it sounds bad.
So we have to reprimand you every time it sounds bad.
But I haven't changed my position of my hand or anything. Anyway, I apologize if the sound is bad. I apologize.
I just can't wait till you yell at me how bad your phone sounds. That's what I'm looking for, the great boomerang, the great guilt boomerang.
Classic.
No.
Now, what was the next one? I think the 5 stars. Let's hear it.
The best podcast ever. I love this podcast. I listen to it every day, all day while I'm working.
Nice.
My employees think I'm crazy. So he's the boss. My employees think I'm crazy because I'm constantly laughing to myself while I'm working. Keep it up, Dave, and toodles for Chris.
That's a solid review, right, Dad?
Yeah, very nice. Yeah.
So I'm going to make a call to the Dopey Nation. Leave a review, make it 5 stars, make it positive, and maybe my dad will read it.
If it's not 5 stars, don't leave it.
That's what I'm saying. What did you say, Dad?
I said, don't complain about my phone quality.
Yeah, I would love a 5-star review that reprimands my dad. That would be the perfect, and then my dad would read it in delicious irony.
That's terrible.
Dad, do you have anything else you want to say to Jay about? Jay also didn't like. Tell him about the cops, Dad. Remember what he said about the cops the first time he was on?
Oh, yeah. Look, anybody who is a policeman, if they're doing it because they're a good person and doing it because they're really protecting people from. I don't think it's very, very nice to complain about cops doing their job to try to get somebody who's selling meat.
You're saying police officers should arrest people that sell fentanyl. You're saying that seems like a good thing for a police officer to do.
Hold on, you guys. In today's New York Times, there's a whole, in the science section, there's a whole article about fentanyl killing people all over the place.
Is Jay mentioned in this article?
No, he's not.
That's good.
I think Jay out of the business. I think Jay is on a new road. That's what I'm thinking.
Jay is.
He's on the road to nowhere.
Jay's on the road going nowhere.
No, fast. No. Jay is. He's. Listen. Jay is on the right foot. I just wanted him to hear some good
reprimandations.
Yes, some reprimanding from an older Jewish gentleman in New York City. I just thought that would be good material for the show.
Well, I hope I did a good job of reprimanding. I hope so.
Do you feel guilted but loved at the same time?
Guilted but loved. Is that like the Jewish reprimand?
That's what he's going for.
That worked.
Anything else you want to add before you go, Dad? Why don't you tell the audience again about your knee and your shoulders and where you're at?
We need to hear it.
You're yelling at me for complaining, but right now I've got to leave the house and go to get on my shoulder and then let them look at my knee while I'm limping over there. I'm not, you know, this is not good. Young and vigorous. Now I'm crutching.
Now listen, I want you to also. A very interesting thing also, though, is that the doctors put him on Vicodin, and he didn't like the way the Vicodins made him feel. So he.
But the same as
the oxycodone. That's Vicodin, yeah. Right? Or hydrocodone. What's Vicodin? Oxycodone?
Percocet.
Okay, the Percocet, which is a better drug than the Vicodin. Cheers. But he went to the. He didn't like it. He went to the pharmacist and they gave him a chemical to render it, you know, impotent.
Really?
Impotent. Dad, yeah, true?
Wait. That, while he was on it?
No.
They gave him one?
I took two pills and the next day I didn't even know who I was. I said, the heck with this stuff. And I had to figure out. And then I went to the drugstore and they gave me this powder and I mixed it together and it's gone.
So that means that people like Jay couldn't sell it wow. After you were done with it. If Jay happened upon this Percocet, he could never move them. Wow. Or if he was moving them, no one could get high from them.
Wow.
No, it would be, you know, you couldn't even ingest it. It turns it into thick. Gooey substance.
Bad for business.
Let me ask you this, Dad, and I want you to be honest, okay? You had all these high octane opioids in your house. Were you worried that I was going to look for them?
Yes.
Oh, come on.
Can't you give me a... So quick.
That's a never-ending thing?
That was so quick.
I don't think I'm ever going to stop worrying, but I'm much better than I was before, that's for sure.
Progress, not perfection.
Yeah, true. he goes, yes, immediately.
Wait, what'd you say that? I can't hear you.
I said, I feel very confident that you're okay. But it's always in the back of my head, though. Yes.
What's coming up with the Dopey Foundation? I'm doing fine. Everything's going great. Are you kidding me?
You're doing fine. Listen, the Dopey Foundation right now, we're waiting for the lawyer to say, you know, to open up, you know, to have a mailing address, to open up a bank account. I mean, right now I'm sitting and waiting. I guess pretty soon I will call them and see what's going on. And what about DopeyCon 3? What's going on with that?
October 1st, special guests are stacking up. Fentanyl Jay is
going
to be there.
It's going down.
Smiling Joe, Brandon Novak, Aaron Carr, perhaps Amy Dresner, Andy Roy. I heard you might be making an appearance and kvetching on stage to the Dopey Nation. Is this true, Dad?
Yeah, most likely. Yeah.
Catered by Katz's. Are you excited?
Oh, yeah. No, it sounds good. It sounds very, very good. Yeah, but you still have work to do on that, I think.
No shit. Oh, it looks like the theater's locked in, though. It looks like we're doing it at Playwrights Horizon.
Oh, that's interesting because the church, I called them two times. He never called me back. So.
Well, maybe if they can make us a better offer than the Playwrights Horizon, then we'll go there. But right now we seem like we have a spot. So I'm excited.
Well, that's good. I left him, you know, I left him another message. So we'll see if he ever calls back. That would be good.
I also want to say to the Dopey Nation before you go, Dad, that there's only going to be 198 seats. So get ready. Tickets are going to go on sale soon. I know they're going to go quickly. You know what I'm saying?
Fly.
They're going to fly off the shelves.
Like hotcakes.
Like Jay's fentanyl. all right, Dad, anything you want to say before you go?
Just everybody be healthy out there and don't. And the article said that all of these quote pills that supposedly are pills are laced with fentanyl.
The fake Xanax and stuff.
The fake blues.
The fake blues.
Oh, and by the way, fentanyl is used as for anesthesia during operations. When I had the knee surgery, I read the report, and they did give me fentanyl. But obviously, that is in control, in terms of the hospital. But the stuff that people order online is deadly. It's horrible, just horrible.
Do you think people are going to start calling you Fentanyl Allen now that you've used some?
No,
Fentanyl Dad.
Don't do that. No, sorry. No.
So do you remember? Do you recall the sensation of what being on fentanyl was like, Dad?
No, absolutely not. You're out. 1 minute you're talking to somebody, the next minute the operation is over.
Sounds about right.
You don't even know what happened at all.
All right. Well, thank you for calling in. That was an enlightening segment. I really appreciated all the stuff you said to Jay.
Thank you, Alan.
Okay, you're quite welcome, and stay good.
I hope you get that shoulder checked out.
He's getting the cortisone shots.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they're shooting him up with the steroids, and it's helping.
Ripped.
It's working out, right, Dad? The shots are doing you good.
We'll see. It's a work in progress. We'll see what happens today when I go.
All right, very good. Well, I love you, and thank you for calling in.
All right, love to you too, and love to Jay also.
Love you more. Okay.
And to and what about the Dopey Nation, Dad? Do you have a message of hope to the Dopey Nation?
And stay strong, Dopey Nation, and toodles to Chris.
And definitely fix that phone, Dad. Sounds terrible. Terrible.
All right, goodbye, Davey.
Bye, Dad. All right.
Do you know that painting looks like Polo G?
Who's Polo? That's Rembrandt. That's Rembrandt painting fucking... I don't remember what that is. It's a very famous painting.
Every time I look at it, I think of Polo G.
Who's Polo G?
It's a rapper.
Rembrandt looks like Polo G.
In that picture, I bet he doesn't look like Polo
G. But that's
G
not Rembrandt. It's Homer contemplating the bust of Ulysses.
Oh, classic.
You know where I got that painting?
Where?
On the street. On 20th Street. It was just there. And I carried it
for
across
town.
Yeah, I just took it.
One of those guys on a subway with like a desk, like.
No, that's where we get out of stuff in this house. But it looks pretty. I think it looks good. I like that. You like the painting?
I do.
What about this little treasure
that
over here?
That's probably my favorite.
Linda bought that one.
I don't know who that is, but it's probably my favorite.
There are a bunch of like jazz heroes painted on this weird thing.
It's a solid painting.
Jay, what do you think of my dad?
He is exactly. I wanted to say it, but I didn't want to say it because I was like, sounds like. I bet I can tell what he looks like. He sounds like exactly what I thought he would sound like. Older Jewish. Oh, Davey,
He looks like an older George Clooney.
Really?
Beautiful.
Really?
Yeah, it's crazy how deformed and ugly I came out considering how beautiful my parents were.
I was surprised to hear he's 6 foot.
Oh, yeah.
I pictured like
athletic.
5'4".
He's fucking shooting jump shots blindfolded.
No way.
Golfing like a fucking pro.
Yeah, golf? Dude's a savage.
Yeah, he's seriously.
How old is this guy?
He's got to be 78.
No way.
Yes.
Shut up.
It's happening.
He's
it's all 78? Happening. Yeah, it's all happening.
Shut up.
Yeah. His I hope that this stuff works
classic
out.
Classic Jewish dad.
For his, as Jewish and classic as it gets. We hope that your shoulders and your knees get better just so I don't have to hear you talk about it anymore.
We do hope that.
But everyone loves my dad, especially me. And I just have to say this. Like, I put him through fucking hell.
I bet you did.
You heard him. He's hiding the pills still. Coming up on 7 years
it's been
clean.
7 years, Dad.
Not yet. But, I don't blame him. You know, there's tons of I'm not even going to tell you, but Linda has there's Xanax in the house.
Locked.
And, no, it's not locked. I told Dopey Nation this. We had a cat that was spraying the beds.
Oh, yeah.
They gave us a bottle of liquid Xanax for the cat. Can you imagine? Exactly. Anyway, Jay, that was a classic appearance, I think. Thank you, Jed. Thank you, Sober Buddy. Sober Buddy is doing these sober challenges. The newest Sober Buddy challenge that I have to do that I haven't done is go to a museum by myself. When's the last time you went to a museum?
Exactly zero times ever.
Ever?
No, maybe when I was a child. Maybe.
Jay is a serial dater, and I think you should
take
a nice young lady to a museum.
Done. Say less. Which one?
Well, do you want me to say names on the show?
No. Which museum?
I don't know. I think you should go to Manhattan. Go to the Metropolitan Museum of Art.
I already got one lined up.
Metropolitan Museum of Art, and we'll do it as the Sober Buddy Challenge when you come back.
I'm with that. Brian Park's free outdoor movie nights will return in June. She just sent me that. We're going to the city.
Very romantic.
Very.
All right. Thank you, Jay. Stay strong, Dopey Nation, and fucking toodles for Chris.
Toodles.
I'm going to play this song, but only because I think it's going to make me look a little bit tired. I'm just going to start an outro.
Tell me you didn't like it.
Yeah,
I'm sure you can relate to the calling your dad part. Dude, it's just really good. Like, where did you write? What did you write? I like the lyrics. I hope they can hear it. Can they hear it?